Hi, I'm Vito Russo.
And I'm Marcia Pally. He died is Querelle, an adaptation of Jean Genet's novel Querelle de Brest. It's a hot film about male beauty, narcissism, sexual conquest, and how they all work together. We have with us here tonight the star of that film, Brad Davis, who plays the irresistible sailor Querelle himself, and he'll be accompanied by the film's producer, Dieter Schidor. Also tonight, we'll have a short skit by two members of the Split Bridges Theatre Company. It's about a woman who dreams of being Katharine Hepburn and another woman who dreams about being Jimmy Dean. After that, we'll have a Stonewall Minute about gay history and some advice from our columnist, Dear Gabby. Vito?
Later on in the show, I'll be talking to Rita Mae Brown, the author of Ruby Fruit Jungle and Southern Discomfort, novel Sudden Death, which is about, guess what, surprise, corruption, sex, power, politics, and love on the women's professional tennis circuit. Also, we're going to be showing you a very old film clip, which is probably containing the first gay character on the American screen, and take you to a Hollywood award show, the Alliance for Gay Artists in the Entertainment Industry, giving out their annual awards to people like Robert Preston, Linda Lavin, Gregory Harrison, and Lynn Redgrave. Right now, why don't you take a look at the first in a series of answers to our question for this week on the street, should rock stars or movie stars, if they're gay, come out of the closet, or will they lose their fans? Well, will they?
For instance, David Bowie and people like Elton John have come out as bisexual, and they say that it hasn't hurt their image with their fans or anything like that. Do you think there's a good reason why, like, most movie star people don't come out, or do you think they should do that? Do you think it would ruin their, you know, credibility with the people who like them in the movies, their audience?
Well, I think that image is an important thing, and I think they have to be very careful about what they say, what they do, how they behave. I think if they are gay, they should come out of the closet. There's nothing to be ashamed of. This has been something that's been happening for thousands of years. I am a straight cat myself, but I know gay people. I've worked as an actor, and I met a lot of gay people, and I don't see no reason why they shouldn't come out of the closet about it, I think.
In just a minute now, Marcia Pally is going to be talking to Dieter Schidor, who is the producer of Fassbinder's Querelle and its star, Brad Davis. But right now, just for a minute or so, we'd like to take you back exactly 60 years to what may be the first gay character in an American motion picture, a film called The Soilers, a gay cowboy in a Stan Laurel comedy, exactly 60 years ago. Watch. Thank you.
Going from a film from 1923 to a film from 1983, we're going to be talking about Querelle. We have with us here tonight the star of Querelle, Brad Davis, who also played the starring role in Midnight Express a couple of years ago, you may remember. And on his right, we have Dieter Schidor, who produced Querelle as well as playing a part in the film, and without whom we wouldn't have any film at all. I think that's what producers do. Brad, I'd like to start by asking you a question. Here we go. Okay. Let me be frank. There are lots of actors who have a whole lot of trouble playing homosexual characters. You seem not to have that problem. There are homoerotic scenes in Midnight Express. There are certainly homoerotic scenes in Querelle. I mean, there are very explicit homoerotic fucking scenes in Querelle. Why are you different? How come you don't seem to freak out?
Well,
we were waiting for that. Now we know.
This may sound odd, but I never saw or thought of Querelle, I still don't, as a homosexual film.
Could you explain that? I mean, given the content, could you explain that?
Yeah, well, I read the book a couple of times before I got the script, and Querelle's character is very, very defined by Genet in the book. He's very careful to let you know exactly who this person is, the way he walks, the way he talks, all the thoughts that go through his head. And I understand this movie is not an adaptation of the book, but that's where I got my character. And Querelle was almost in the book, he walked in a place separate from all people and from all sexuality, homosexual and heterosexual. He didn't relate to people that way or sex that way. Sex became, in the course of the book and in the course of the film, a tool to be used for a greater purpose in his evolution of himself. And this, like you call them, the homoerotic fuck scenes, they were, I don't know how erotic they are or how homo they are, but they're definitely fuck scenes. It started out as a form of execution for himself. Querelle didn't have sex with other people. He always had sex with himself, no matter who he was with. It was a tool for a greater end. And his, as he related to all things, his relation to sex was a relationship with death. It was not that he wanted a man, or he wanted this, you know what I'm saying? Or like people want men, or they want women.
Yeah.
It was he needed this, at this point in his life, he needed a tool to take him even further into death.
Well, I want to sort of be obnoxious and press this for a minute, because in fact that's actually clear in the film that he's most of all having everything with himself, sex and every other thing with himself more than anybody else. That I think was very clearly conveyed by your character, by the filming. But nevertheless, he does do these things with men, and there are still actors in Europe, in this country, who won't take a role. They're afraid that their careers will go smashing down the tubes.
God.
And I don't think it'll show up on camera. So I guess the question still remains for me, given that you have to do those things, and why are you willing to do it?
I almost didn't take this part.
Because of that reason?
Yeah, because of, as it took me 2 weeks I really wrestled, because I really wanted to work with Rainer a lot, a real lot. We were going to work together on a different film that we'd met a couple of years before, and we were going to do this film, but it never happened, and that was the film I wanted to do with him. Querelle came up and he sent me a telegram and wanted me to play it, and I go, oh great, and somebody went out and got me the book. And I started reading it, and I said, oh my God.
Here goes my career.
Oh my God. And they wanted me to commit to do it by the book, and I said, no, absolutely not. I have to see a script, you know, of what's going to be done with this, because it could, you know, I mean. And so a month to the day later, a script arrived in the hands of this young fellow here, and
that's Dieter.
We had a talk over at lunch when he gave me the script, and he lied through his teeth to me.
There would be no fuck scenes at all.
Oh
in
yes,
the film.
I said, look, you know, I'm an American actor, and I don't know how it is in Europe, but I can't be seen getting fucked in the ass on film. I mean, I just, oh no, I don't think you should. No, that would never. And he went on and on, and see, I was in just such a state of fear that he did probably the only thing, you know, right to do, which is just to let me get through this fear. And I did a lot of, and I liked the book. I mean, it's great literature. I mean, like is not the word. You don't like Querelle. You don't like reading the book. What you do is you find things, you find yourself going through a trip in your own mind and body. And the places it takes you are not the places I think that you're taken with what you see in life usually, you know.
It's
Janae's world, and his world is very private, and it's his particular view of it.
Well, how do you feel about it now that you know that, in fact, that there are fuck scenes in the film and millions of Americans will see you as in that compromising position?
Okay, so I did a lot of soul searching, and I couldn't figure out why I was still so afraid. I mean, I knew I was afraid, but I couldn't imagine why, because I'd always, okay, anyway, I finally realized that at the end of 2 weeks that there was this very small, that I didn't know was there, bourgeois mouse had raised his little head up in the back of my psyche and was screaming, screaming for just total panic and fear of basically being persecuted, which I thought never ended my life, because I thought I lived very bravely and dangerously, but this was really dangerous. After the first day of shooting, I didn't have any fear at all, because I knew everything was right. Whatever was going to be done in this film would be right. And today, how I feel about it, I'm very proud of Querelle. And how people feel about it, I do care about. Is that 4 minutes or 4 seconds?
It's 4 minutes. I want to talk to Dieter too. So
okay. Whatever they feel about it, whatever they write about it, whatever they say about it, you know, I hope it's, you know, favorable. But if it's not, it really doesn't matter in the long run, because Querelle wasn't made for now to be put out and make money and be the kind of success that films are made to be. Now, Querelle was made forever, and it'll last forever. When this generation, with its mores, and whatever goes on, and another generation comes up and its mores change, or whatever, Querelle will be steadfast, and I think my child's children will see it.
And see granddad getting fucked in the ass, and not care. That'll be the victory, and not care. Dieter, I wanted to ask you, A couple of questions about that. I read in an interview that I think was done in The Native that that you were going to do the film before you signed Fassbinder on as a director, and I wanted to ask you what got to you about the book. Why this book? Of all Genet's work, why Genet? You know, why this film?
When I was 18, I was starting to study law in Kiel, in a small provincial university town north in Germany. Somebody gave me the book, and I suddenly discovered something, you know, secret fears, hidden desires that I didn't really know and which came out through the book, a way of thinking that I did not think was possible. I grew up in a very bourgeois family. My father's an architect in Brunswick. And it sort of stayed in my mind. And then when I was finished and I thought about producing a film because I wanted to do it, I thought of the book and then I thought of Querelle. And I thought at the same time of Fassbinder, who had done one film with a gay subject, which I hate, which is Fox and His Friends, which I find a very sentimental, kitschy, gay soap opera.
And you signed him on anyway, even though you didn't like
that? I like him as a director. It was, you know, he's done films that are my favorite films of our films. And then we met, and I said, and we were sort of, we had broken apart out of different reasons. But then we met in a Japanese restaurant, and he said, yeah, I'm going to do the film. I knew he had the novel always with him. You know, this was his favorite book. And he said, I'm going to have this to be the story of our Lord. And then he got scared, so that we didn't get together. No contracts were signed. He backed out of it.
Because of the homosexuality? The violence?
Whether it's the homosexuality, whether it's the attacking of all the taboos that are in Querelle. I mean, it's homosexuality, it's murder, it's incest, it's one of the worst things, I think, which gets people scared, is the betrayal of your best friend when Querelle gives over his friend,
Gilles,
to the police to make him immortal and himself. And he was afraid. He was afraid of walking on this rope in between kitsch and fascism, and I don't think he really knew how he was going to do it. And then I spoke with other directors before I came back to Fassbinder, then with Bernardo Bertolucci and with Werner Schröter.
And then you finally decided on Fassbinder.
Yeah, it didn't work. And then about a year later, I called him and the thing was breaking apart. And Bertolucci said, this film can't be done before 10 years from now. Uh-huh. And
so Brad was right, it's really done for the future.
I don't know, we'll see.
Let me ask you, how much of the film was finished before Fassbinder died?
Everything.
Including the voiceover and the title cards?
And the title cards and the voiceover.
So were those his choices to put in the title cards and the voiceover?
Yes.
What went into that choice?
In which choice now? In the voices or in
the title? The title cards.
Well, they were Fassbinder's personal private likings, because they're not all from Genet. There's two from Genet, I think, and the others are from different authors. The things he had read, which he had liked, which to him seemed to make sense. And he wanted to, you know, really stab it like a knife into the heart of the audience when the white light comes up and then you see another form of objectivity, you know, thrown at you.
Yeah. I unfortunately, I think we're out of time, and this is really too bad because I think that everybody would like to hear much more from both of you. I certainly do hope that if whatever the response to the film is, that homophobia doesn't get into it, and that the film is evaluated as a piece of art. You know, whatever people say, that they evaluate it on that basis, and not simply because it's breaking taboos, as you suggested. So I'd also like to thank you for taking time from your busy tour, really, for your promotional tour, to come and talk to us. Thank
sure.
you.
Okay. Thank you.
Coming up right now, we have an excerpt from a play called Beauty and the Beast. It's performed by the Split Bridges Theatre Company. This is an all-women's production unit based here in New York that they write, direct, produce, perform all their own material. And as if that weren't work enough, they also run a cafe called the Wow Cafe in the East Village. It's a women's performance space that does performances for half a week and houses workshops and classes for the other half. I think they also offer a Sunday brunch. Okay, now we're going to go to a slightly also altered version of the play Beauty and the Beast.
No.
Why?
Well, I can't.
Why not?
What would our children be like?
Well, marry me, Beauty.
No, Beast.
I'll take you to Mount Olympus and feed you mint and honey from my hand.
Well, I like your fried chicken.
I'll be Gertrude Stein to your Alice B. Toklas. I'll be Spencer Tracy to your Katherine Hepburn. I'll be James Dean to your Montgomery Clift?
Well, I always wanted to be Katharine Hepburn.
Now, I always wanted to be James Dean.
I was Katharine Hepburn.
I was James Dean.
I was Katharine Hepburn. And the girl who lived down the hall from me freshman year in college was Spencer Tracy.
I was James Dean. And when I slept with a woman for the first time, she threw me out of bed on the floor and said I was sick.
Spencer used to write me poems. Bring me roses in the morning and take me for rides in her red convertible.
I went to work the next day. I passed out and I was in a coma for 2 weeks.
For Christmas, Spencer bought me a white fur coat.
Not only did I have spinal meningitis, but I had mononucleosis. And the doctor told me I couldn't kiss a boy for a year.
My mother told me that I shouldn't accept expensive gifts from girls. But I wasn't worried. She wasn't a girl. She was Spencer Tracy.
Then my girlfriend got married to a boy who thought he was James Dean. So I married a boy who thought he was Lauren Bacall.
One evening, Spencer and I decided to go out to the movies together. And when we were leaving the dormitory, by mistake, we checked the dating instead of the non-dating column.
Then one day I fell in love with a woman at work, and she fell in love with me.
And when we got home that evening, the door mother was in the doorway, and she wanted to know just what had been going on.
All my fantasies were turning into realities, so I went to a shrink. And I fell in love with her, too.
And as far as I knew, nothing had been going on. But later that evening, they took Spencer to the hospital in a straitjacket.
I got all my stuff together. I left Lauren Bacall. And I moved in with the woman from work, only to find out she thought she was James Dean.
And I found out later that she wasn't Spencer Tracy at all. And I found out much later that I had been in love with her.
Will you marry me then, Beauty? I'll be back tomorrow.
We're at the Open Gate Theater in the bowels of Bellevue Hospital on East 29th Street, watching a rehearsal of Beauty and the Beast, one of the two plays being performed by the Split Bridges Theater Company. As you can see, I've become an honorary member of the company, and I'm here to tell you that I, too, thought I was Katharine Hepburn. Sitting with me, I have Peggy Shaw and Lois Weaver. You are directors of the company, or... I have to get rid of this. Tell me what you are in the Split Bridges company.
Well, we're everything, really. I mean, we're a four-person company, three performers and one technician. I do most of the directing. We write collaboratively. We work collaboratively, we produce ourselves, we organize our tours. We are it. We are Split Bridges Company.
So the four of you are Lois Weaver and Peggy Shaw and...
Deborah Margolin, who's another performer, and Alice Forrester, who is our technician.
What kind of theater do you do in general?
Personal theater, I guess. I mean, is that what you mean?
Are you working with a particular body of themes or a particular set of interests? Gay interests, women's interests, lesbian interests, or what?
Whatever is bothering or thrilling us at the time.
Or whoever is bothering.
Or whoever.
Split Bridges is a real celebration of women's lives, a lot of forgotten women's lives. I mean, these were eccentrics that have often been put down, but never really celebrated. And we really wanted to bring them to life and their craziness to life. And one of the characters is a lesbian, Adela, who obviously never was able to come out. So we wanted to celebrate her life in a way. And in Beauty and the Beast, we deal with a lot of different kinds of political themes. We talk about Reagan, and we talk about being gay, and we talk about being Jewish, and we talk about what it's like to grow up Christian and Salvation Army influence and religion.
Debbie plays an old Jewish Hasidic rabbi. On Toshus.
Yeah, what kind of theater do you hope to be doing in the future? Do you have any plays, upcoming plays, or ideas, or political topics that you want to touch on?
We want to do a circus, basically. we really want to go out a little bit into where other kinds of lives
honestly,
are happening.
I really miss the vaudeville circuit. I mean, I think I missed my time. You know, that sense of going from town to town, pulling in, doing a show, staying there till you make enough money to get to the next town. That's a lot of what we do in Europe. And I would love to be able to do that in our country and sort of establish that kind of circuit for small theater groups in our country and to live that way, just always doing your work, not plastering houses and then doing your work at night. Like,
could you tell me something about yourselves? How'd you get involved in theater?
Well, I was a famous American printmaker and painter. And then I was a famous American social worker.
Ah, yes.
And then I met this group of crazy queens, the Hot Peaches, on the streets of New York when they were doing street theater back in the early 70s. And then I have a kid, too. And I gave up being a social worker and went with them to Europe with no money. And we stayed for 2 years doing shows on a gay tour from England all the way down to Vienna. And then we wrote another show and went around again. So that's how I started doing theater with them. I was designing their sets, and then they got me to get on the stage.
Was this all gay men and you? Was that
well,
your
when arrangement? When we toured, it was.
Yeah.
But in New York, they had a lot of women working with them, too. But on tour, it was a smaller company, and I was the only woman.
But I was born wanting to do theater, I think. I mean, I used to dance around the house, and we have a line in Split Bridges where Emma says to me, how do you expect to be a Christian and thinking about dancing all the time? And my mother actually said that to me. And then I went away to school, which was all of 40 miles further into the Blue Ridge Mountains when I went to college. And I started to do theater there. And I did it pretty much nonstop for 4 years, learned a lot. Then I became politically conscious. And I thought, well, the theater is a luxury of the middle class, and I have to do something about this world. It was right in the Vietnam War. And so I decided to leave theater behind, go to Baltimore, and do some political organizing, which I did, and felt pretty defeated about for the most part, because it was hard at that point to be a woman
in the left.
And I had gone to a women's school. I went to school with 4,000 women. I did everything I wanted to do. I directed, I built the sets. I didn't know from that sort of discrimination until I went out into the world. But in the meantime, I joined a theater company in Baltimore because I couldn't stay away. And it was an experimental theater company, and they were trying to combine political issues with theater. And I thought, aha, this seems to make sense. And
okay, I think we're going to have to wrap it up right
okay.
now. I want to thank you again. This is Lois Weaver and Peggy Shaw from the Split Bridges Theater Company.
This portion of our time is brought to you by Christopher Street Magazine.
Performers who are in the public eye, like rock stars or movie stars, do you think there's a good reason why those people don't come out? Do you think that, for instance, some of them say that their fans wouldn't like them anymore? Do you think that that's like a fear that's grounded in fact?
Yeah, I think to a certain extent it is. If someone came out, maybe, you know, someone who people think is a hard character comes out and says that he's gay, it might definitely hurt their image. But people who are more flamboyant and more effeminate, I don't think why they shouldn't speak their minds, because, you know, it's kind of obvious anyway, or at least people assume it to begin with. So it depends on the actor.
There are a lot of people who are rock stars and who have come out, and people have accepted them for what they are, for their talents, more than because they're gay or not. They're like Joe Jackson, you know, he's, you know, gay, and there's a lot of different other people who are gay, and I just think that, no, I don't, you know, they should do what they feel is best.
I feel that rock stars don't want to be exposed because of the fact that people will probably do worse things, will probably think worse things of them, or would make such actions and gestures that are so preposterous that it really wouldn't matter. I think that people should learn to accept people and as just people and not blow things up so much.
A lot of actors and a lot of rock stars feel that they can't come out because it would hurt their image with the audience. Do you think that that holds true for most of them? Would they lose their fans?
I don't think so. I think male sex symbols might. Not naming one. I don't think most of them would. I mean, if their image wasn't largely based on their sex appeal.
I don't know. I don't know whether they've got to the stage where Harvey Fierstein can play a regular macho cowboy, but I think it's true that most rock stars, I mean, do, and movie stars do worry about whether their audience can identify with them as playing a straight man if they were to come out of the closet.
Justice by simply being more compassionate and more understanding.
And his world, in the discussion, were eight practicing homosexuals.
The man who was instrumental in bringing about that 1962 radio broadcast was Randy Wicker.
The one radio program led into a lot of other radio programs, and that resulted in the Les Crane show putting me on as the first homosexual on television. Reactions from the show were enormous because I was first attacked in the Journal American as a card-carrying swish. It was big news because for the first time homosexuals were speaking for themselves. They taped a second program, but after they advertised it and taped it, some of the affiliates said, if you have someone like that on the air, put a pervert like that on the air, we will no longer ever again carry the Les Crane show.
Hi, we've just had another Stonewall Minute, a brief bit of gay history produced each week by Joe Windisch. And now coming up, we have our time's very own advice columnist who has some words of wisdom and comfort for the lonely and lovelorn, or is that the horny and bar-worn? Anyway, see if you can guess what famous lesbian writer is moonlighting as our time's Dear Gabby. Let's take a look.
This is Gabby Tidbit with all the poop that's fit to scoop. Today, I'm going to be answering some of my letters. Now, let me see. Oh, I think I'll get this nice big one. What's in here? Ugh, Spanish moss. This letter must be from the South. I wonder if it's good luck to throw this over your shoulder. Okay, here we go. Ugh. Dear Gabby, I have a terrible problem. My lover and I were living on a lovely plantation in Virginia. Recently, she met a Yankee woman and left me cold with this big house, five cats, three cars, a labyrinth-shaped swimming pool, and a dumb old tennis court. Since she left me, all I want to do is sit in the back of the rolls and cry on the cats. What's a poor old Southern dyke to do? Hope y'all have some remedy for my Southern discomfort. Signed, R.M.B. Of course, that stands for Really Mad Bachelorette. Now let me think. If this were mint julep, it would be so much clearer. If I were you, I'd write a book about it and save your Dixie cups, honey, for the South will rise again.
I'd like to welcome my guest, Rita Mae Brown, who has created a sensation all of her life, first with Ruby Fruit Jungle, and still creates a sensation everywhere she goes, is, according to most women and men in the United States, hotter than Tom Selleck combined with Katharine Hepburn combined with Olivia Newton-John.
If only it were
Isn't
true.
That right? Welcome. I'm glad you're here.
Thank you.
Let's talk first about your new book, Sudden Death. Sudden Death is extraordinary because I was amazed at the viciousness of the women's tennis circuit as portrayed in the book. Is it really such deadly, serious politics? I mean, it seemed to me like everybody in the book put money and power and fame before anything else except Harriet, who I take to be you, by the way.
No.
I don't know if that's true.
It's not. Harriet's far nicer than I am. Individual pro sports are different than team sports, but the main goal is ego. You want to win. You want to be the best. And money. And when you apply that to a sport like golf or tennis or whatever can be an individual sport, nobody can make a bond with anybody else. You know, everybody's out there performing the same function, essentially, but unable to make real friendships because you might have to go out and try to kill that girl the next day, essentially. So it creates a very antiseptic atmosphere and sometimes a trifle cruel, but that's true in any pro sport.
You think that?
I think
that's
so.
Right. See, because I thought it was an awfully ugly picture of, I mean, maybe even as a reader, I just had an aversion to the ugliness of the way they dealt with one another on the level of the lesbian politics, for instance. You really do paint a vivid portrait of women who do not want to be exposed as lesbians for any reason, under any circumstances, and will do anything. Will marry men they'd never met before. You know, will deny it in public.
That's true, but I also think that's true in Hollywood. I'm not gonna put the burden of this on 14-year-old girls in pigtails. The truth is that nobody gets rewarded for homosexuality, and a homosexual is the only person who has to ask the question, am I going to be hated for what I am or loved for what I am not? And when you add a couple million dollars to that question, the choice for most people is very easy.
Yeah.
So you've got satin-lined closets, but eventually those will become increasingly confining to anybody. It's horrible to see what gay people do to themselves. Because, you know, if they banded together, it wouldn't be an issue for anybody. It wouldn't be an issue in Hollywood. It wouldn't be an issue in the medical world. It wouldn't be an issue in the tennis or golf worlds or football or any of that. It would just be over and done with. But the point is, every gay person thinks, I can slip by. They'll never figure out it's me.
Right. Is that because who holds the power? You know, one says if every gay person would band together, and the truth is usually that as rich and famous and powerful as they think lesbians and gay men are in Hollywood and in sports, that it's very often heterosexual people who really hold the real power, and that only the secondary power is held by the stars or by the gay people who are, you know, working before the camera. Do you suppose that that's the case, that there's no real power held in the lesbian and gay community in any way?
Very little. Not as much as we would like. I mean, the only way we're going to have real power is if we make common cause. Wherever we are, it doesn't matter what our field is. And at present, I'm sorry to report, we are unwilling to do that. I mean, I find it very difficult to believe that I'm the only woman in America who will admit to sometimes loving other women. But so far, there's me and maybe one or two others. Now, we know statistically that's not true.
Well, can we talk a little bit about London? You and I ran into each other in London when Martina was playing at Wimbledon. Now, there are sequences in the book which, if they're not about you and Martina, that they closely parallel what I saw going on in London. You were hounded by the scandal press in London mercilessly. I mean, I remember them following you from your hotel out to the tennis courts.
They were pretty bad.
And there's a similar situation in Sudden Death where Harriet is tricked by this awful sports writer into announcing her lesbianism, and then Carmen, her lover, who's a professional tennis star, is made almost made to pay the price for it. Did you find that you were being used as scapegoat?
Sure. All along, because I would say who and what I was, although I was very quiet about it. I mean, in sense of publicly, I never made a pronouncement, and I've only really had one other lover in my life who was also a public person, and I never said a word about her. But if they can pick on you, they will, and if they can try to drive the others out, they will. In terms of sudden death, though, I want to be real clear. Sudden death isn't about real people. The world is real, but the people, in other words, let me put it this way. Marianne Moore said poetry is imaginary gardens with real toads in it. Sudden death is real gardens with imaginary toads. Because I couldn't really present people that are alive now. That would have been unfair to them. But I can certainly show the pressures that anybody in that world would be under, and that's what I tried to do.
Mm-hmm. You once said that you're not interested in sex, only in how people love each other. And a long time before that, you said that love is bullshit and that sex is where it's at. Do you constantly have this prerogative to waver back and forth on the subject of sex and love?
I think it's getting older. When I was a kid, I was a kid in the 60s. I mean, nobody ever thought about love or commitment. That was, you were too busy trying to make the revolution, mm-hmm. right? When you get older, things look a lot different.
Does that change for you as you get older in terms also of your public face? In The Furies in 1972, you wrote this article about star versus leader in the mm-hmm. lesbian movement. And when essentially what you said in that piece was, don't let them make you a star, because if you let them make you a star, they will force you to denounce your lesbianism in favor of some sort of bisexual liberalism that's more acceptable to the straight, public. And do you feel that you're asked to make compromises like that as you go along, that people want you to be a star, or that maybe lesbian people want you to be a star and then they really don't want that after all, like they'll come down on you for being a star? Do you feel that, you don't have the sort of lesbian feminist politic that you started out with because of what's happened to you in your life?
No. Again, I've gotten older. And that's made all the difference in my life. I'm not so easily seduced by ideology. What looks good on the page isn't necessarily what works out in the street with people. But I've always distinguished the difference between a star and a leader. A leader has community support. A leader has a system that she or he can move through, and there's accountability both ways. We still don't have that. Much as I might want to be a leader, I'm not. But I have become a star by virtue of talent and sometimes a ready wit.
Do you like it?
It's all right. It's not why I'm here.
Right.
But if it's the way to achieve my ends, I will accept it. I sound, sort of grudging about it, like fame is awful. It's okay, but I'm essentially a really private person. I think most writers are. But if there's just one person in America who will stand up and say, look, loving women is really okay, and look at me, I faintly resemble one. We don't all run around in motorcycle jackets. That's something. In a strange way, whether I like it or not, I've been propelled forward to be an example. And I will do it, knowing I can't possibly represent gay women. Everyone's different from everyone else.
Yeah. In a minute or so that we have left, it seems, can you tell me why Ruby Fruit Jungle is not a movie?
Oh, I don't have the money to buy the rights back from the people who own it.
Do you think it's ever going to happen?
I don't know. If I had the money, it would. I need $125,000, and I haven't got it.
Oh, that doesn't seem like an awful lot of money, right?
Well, it's not that much money for the rights, but it's still a tricky business. You know how cowardly people are. So if I get it back, I know I'll get it made, but I just don't have the cold cash. I'll get it.
You will. Thanks for coming today.
Thank you.
I'm sorry it was so brief.
Me too.
But we'll do it again. I want to introduce also a film segment that we have from Hollywood. Speaking of Hollywood's cowardice, there are some actors in Hollywood who have gotten together under the title of the Alliance for Gay Artists in the Entertainment Industry. And they presented awards for good work done in portraying lesbians and gay men on the screen. And we'd like to take you to the Hollywood Awards ceremony of the Alliance for Gay Artists in the Entertainment Industry, where Robert Preston won for Best Supporting Actor for Victor Victoria. And the presenters included Lynn Redgrave, Gregory Harrison, Linda Lavin, Ned Beatty, and Bernadette Peters. Watch.
For the evening, Lynn Redgrave and Gregory Harrison.
Thank you. Thank you very much. My opening statement had to do with that. It's that you're not to worry because we're not at the Dorothy Chandler Pavilion. This isn't the Oscars, and we promised to get you home by tomorrow.
We have some truly entertaining or interesting awards to award. Presentable people to present them, and some very entertaining entertainers.
And we're here to acknowledge the good work that our winners have done.
And to call attention to the Alliance for Gay Artists in the Entertainment Industry.
Now, some of you here probably haven't heard of the AGA before, and that's not surprising. AGA isn't a pressure group that runs around holding press conferences and picketing. They're just too busy working quietly within our industry to promote the realistic representation of gay, lesbian characters and issues.
AGA acts as a resource and consultation group to producers and writers. They monitor television, film, local radio, and theater. Open monthly meetings are held at which speakers and programs are presented to help broaden the entertainment industry and the gay community's understanding of each other.
And what's really unique about the AGA is that it advocates from within the system. Now, most advocacy groups don't know a thing about the way our business is run. And nearly all of AGA's members are employed within this business. And this makes them realistic in their goals and in their methods.
Listen to this, Lynn. Quote, it is our hope to see homosexual characters and issues portrayed in a vigorously lifelike manner, end quote. Vigorously lifelike, I like that.
Yeah, and so do I. And that's why we're all here tonight. So, to honor our winners who have all done just that.
Please join me in welcoming TV's favorite waitress, Linda Lavin.
Those of us who toil in the vineyards of episodic television know how difficult it can be to produce a vintage crop, and it can be even harder to produce a wine of unique character, and we're not talking about Falcon Crest. I'm particularly pleased to be presenting the TV Awards tonight because in the Gaze of Our Lives episode of House Calls, prejudice against a new homosexual employee of the hospital was shown to be a silly, ignorant, and frightened response. And once educated by an example of the violence such prejudice can lead to, the gay character was accepted, even embraced. If it sounds like an object lesson, it was, but it was a skillfully entertaining one. The story was by Sam Greenbaum, written and produced by Kathy Voltz Greer and Bill Greer, and executive producers were Arthur Gregory and Jerry Davis. Accepting for House Calls are Sam Greenbaum, Kathy Greer, and Bill Greer.
I'd like to thank all the members of the Animal Guild of America. You're kidding. I'm sorry. Actually, we wrote this particular script not to depict the sad plight of homosexuals in America, but rather to depict the tragic plight of many non-gay people who, through prejudice and misconception, deprive themselves of the joy that we have known in meeting and knowing and learning to love and work with so many beautiful, productive members of the gay community. Apparently, we achieved our objective because we're here receiving this award and Anita Bryant isn't. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
See, actors can be identified with the roles they play. It happens sometimes to us, and especially when they play a controversial character, and sometimes they play it very well. So it takes a certain amount of courage and fortitude for an actor to take on a gay or a lesbian role.
Yeah. It's weird, isn't it? When you play Medea, nobody naturally assumes you're a child murderer.
I mean, it's says on the card, this lady here has played prostitutes and things and done it very well, I might add. And, but we don't assume from that that she does naughty things for money. Don't.
Am I being paid for this show tonight?
No, you're not. Nobody's being paid for this show.
Oh, good. Then I'm safe.
That's right. We're here to honor several actors who took the kind of risk we've been talking about and whose portrayals of gay and lesbian human beings have enriched our lives over these past months.
And remember, these brave souls risk being mistaken for human beings. Robert Preston has had a long and distinguished career. This actor's actor has graced our screens and stages in a wide variety of roles, to each of which he has brought a uniquely American blend of courage, intelligence, dignity, and pizzazz. And when he has played con men, he has made us want to be fooled. And when he has played villains, he has made us admire their villainy. And when he has played heroes, he has made us want to be saved by him and him alone. And I should know because I had the great good fortune to play opposite him in Mac and Mabel, and it's an experience I'll never forget. And now in Victor Victoria, playing Toddy, the uncompromising, unrepentant, and unflappable homosexual best friend of Julie Andrews, he has made us want to be befriended by just such a man, regardless of his sexuality. We can only thank him for applying his golden touch to our lives once again. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Robert Preston.
You too, Ned.
Thank you.
I was going to say that I was tickled pink to be here, but I decided not to. I think you'll understand what I mean when I say that when I was preparing to play Toddy in Victor Victoria, I didn't pay too much attention to the gay community. I knew too many Toddies in my long and checkered career, and I knew them well. And for those who are dead, I've met a few more tonight who'll take their place. But I did have to worry a little bit about what we have grown to call the straight bunch, simply because we know too many of them still today, and it's getting smaller all the time, but too many still run into their own particular closet if you just mention the word gay. So I had to decide what I'd do for them. And I'm glad to tell you that the thing that answered the purpose was absolute honesty. Just to play the happiness of the guy and the normality of the man. And, of course, the fact that he was a little humorous and quite outrageous didn't hurt. But I also had to be careful not to fall into the trap that I have seen happen. That is, to play against what you're doing. And to have the audience saying, oh, that's Robert Preston, and we know him, we've seen him for years and years, and we know he's not gay. So I have won on both instances, I think. The audience has accepted Toddy. They've taken him to his heart, which is a step forward for everyone. And they also now say, that's Robert Preston up there. playing that part, and we know he's not gay. Or is he?
Don't you think Robert Preston should have won the Oscar?
Yeah, he should have. It would have been the first time that an actor ever won an Oscar for playing a gay character.
Damn.
Ridiculous.
Well, okay. I think that wraps about wraps up our show.
Not quite. It doesn't quite wrap up our show. One more thing, Marcia. Our last item tonight is about the Hoof and Mouth Disease Award, which we'd like to give to little Joni Baez, who said a few things about her lesbian audience in Rolling Stone magazine recently, which I think might upset some lesbian feminists who thought that Joan Baez actually knew the score. In Rolling Stone magazine recently, Rolling Stone asked if Joan Baez was involved with anyone currently, and she asked Rolling Stone to help her out, and I quote, "I am absolutely deluged with homosexual women at my concerts," says Joan. Rolling Stone suggested that that was because 10 years ago, Joan Baez said she was bisexual, but Joni says no. They were there before she said she was bisexual. And I quote, Joan Baez says, "I am definitely not interested," and goes on to complain that she can't meet guys because they take off on her when they discover her surrounded by 25 lesbians after one of her concerts. And she just moans, "Terrific." So, Joan Baez may have a handle on Cambodia, but she doesn't seem to know diddly shit when it comes to lesbian feminist politics, and we think that she could have phrased her objections a little bit more, with a little bit more regard for her lesbian audience. Very stupid, Joni.
Maybe she's afraid that she's surrounded by all these gay women, she'll catch it. Wouldn't that be wonderful?
That would be wonderful.
Okay, what you've just seen is the 10th of 13 shows that we'll be doing, which that means that in 3 weeks we'll be off the air. If you'd like to see us continue, we could really use some letters of support from you, and we'll also accept critical letters begrudgingly. If you'd like to send us some mail, please address it to Our Time, WNYC-TV, Municipal Building, 1 Center Street, New York, New York, 1007. I'm Marcia Pally, and for all of us in Our Time, good night.
There's always going to be that portion of society that's going to be very condemning towards any particular group. But I think, like with Elton John, I mean, everybody knew he was bisexual, and his music still had the same appeal for everybody else. And I think that if it's really good music, which is really hard to find these days, no one's going to care one way or another. Thank you.